فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، إن شاء الله today's topic بإذن الله الكريم will not be the topic that we used to talk about. Inshallah today بإذن الله الكريم, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills, the topic will be different inshallah. And I called it Tasfiyatul Ahwal Bitasfiyatil A'mal. Tasfiyatil Ahwal Bitasfiyatil A'mal, which basically means with good condition, or for us to obtain a good condition and a good state will only occur if we have, or if we come with a good action. If a good action is found in us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make our condition and our state good. And my goal inshallah is to prove this from the kitab, from the sunnah, and from the speech of the pious predecessors. So please pay attention with me. For inshallah this very short reminder will wallahi be an answer for so much questions that people may ask. قال الله تعالى الله سبحانه وتعالى he said in the Quran إن الله لا يغير ما بقوم حتى يغير ما بأنفسهم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala isn't one that changes. ما بقوم, that which a people are upon. Allah does not change it. Allah does not change a people's situation. حتى until يغير ما بأنفسهم, until they change that which is within them. What does this mean? قال ابن جرير الطبري رحمه الله. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari rahimahullah, Imam al-Mufassirin, he was a scholar of tafsir. He said, commenting on this ayah, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ مِنْ عَافِيَةٍ وَنِعْمَةٍ فَيُزِيلُ ذَلِكَ عَنْهُمْ وَيُهْلِكُهُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ, Allah does not change a people, min afiyatin, from the health that they are upon, the good condition that they are in, wa ni'matin, and the great blessings that they are upon. Fa yuzilu dhalika, Allah will not remove that from them. Wa yuhlikuhum, and Allah will not destroy them. Hatta until yughayyiru ma bi anfusihim, until they change that which they were upon, the good that they were doing. What does the Ibn Jarir goes on to say? Min dhalika bi dhulmi ba'dihim ba'da, by them oppressing one another, transgressing on one another. وَاعْتِدَاءِ بَعْضِهِمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ, and group of them overstepping their boundaries over the others. When they do that, فَيَحُلَّ بِهِمْ حِينَئِذٍ عُقُوبَتَهُ وَتَغْيِيرَهُ, and then after that what happens is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it occur on them, عُقُوبَتَهُ, his punishment. وَتَغْيِيرَهُ, and Allah will change their affairs for them. Brothers and sisters, look at this principle, how easy and how simple it is. They were upon ni'mah, they were upon blessing, they changed from it. When they changed by oppressing one another, wronging one another, going against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not doing that which they were ordered to do, فَيَحُلَّ بِهِمْ, then it will occur on them, عُقُوبَتَهُ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's punishment. وَتَغْيِيرَ, and Allah will change their good that they were in into something worse that they weren't upon. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari rahimahullah, he brought his chain of narration from him to Ibrahim al-Nakha'i. He brought it to who? To Ibrahim al-Nakha'i. And also Ibn Kathir brought the qawl of Ibn Abi Hatim for up to Ibrahim al-Nakha'i. He also brought it in his tafsir. That to who? To Ibrahim al-Nakha'i, that he said. He said, أوحى الله إلى نبي من أنبياء بني إسرائيل. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a revelation to a prophet from the prophets of the people of Israel. Allah sent a revelation to a prophet from them. This is what he said to him, this prophet. He said to this prophet, "An qul li qawmika," say to your people, "innahu laysa min ahli qaryatin," that there isn't a people of a village or a town, "wala ahla baytin," and a people of a house, "yakunun ala ta'atillah," that are upon the obedience of Allah. "Fayatahawwalunahu," then remove themselves, they turn away from the obedience of Allah that they were upon. "Minha ila ma'asiyatillah," they turn away from the obedience of Allah to what? To the disobedience of Allah. "Illa hawwalallah," except Allah will divert from them. "Mimma yuhibbuhu," that which he loves subhanahu wa ta'ala, "ila ma," "mimma yuhibbuna," to that which they loved. "Ila mimma," to that which, "ila ma yakrahuna," to that which they dislike. A people, do not turn away from that obedience that they were upon to that which is a disobedience of Allah, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will turn their good affairs into that which is evil or that which is bad. Ibrahim al-Nakha'i went on to say, "Thumma misdaqu dhalik," and the example for that is in the book of Allah, which is the ayah that I recited at the beginning, "Inna Allah la yughayyiru ma biqawmin hatta yughayyiru ma bi anfusihim." Allah does not change a situation of a people and their condition until they change their actions and their good doing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said in another verse, subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Dhalika," and that is, "bi anna Allah," that Allah, "lam yaku mughayyiran," Allah is not one that changes, "ni'matan," a blessing, "an'amaha ala qawmin," a blessing that He blesses over a people, "hatta," until, "yughayyiru ma bi anfusihim," until they change their situation, they change their condition. "Wa anna Allah sami'un alim," and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all hear and all seer and all knower. Here, brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the people of Quraysh. The blessings that they were upon, the ni'mas that they had, the trading that used to happen for them in Mecca. When Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam came to them and he conveyed Islam to them and they did not go with it, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would change that which they were upon. قال الله تعالى, Allah said to Quraysh, فَلْيَعْبُدُوا رَبَّ هَذَا الْبَيْتِ, worship the Lord of this bait, الَّذِي أَطْعَمَهُمْ مِنْ جُوعٍ وَآمَنَهُمْ مِنْ خَوْفٍ, the one who provided for them food to eat and the one that saved them from what? Who gave them safety and tranquility. Please ponder. Two things is what a person needs to live a good life. It is food to eat and safety. If you have those two, it's a blessing that Allah has bestowed upon you. Allah is saying to you, because I have given you this ni'mah, because I have done this for you, worship that Lord so that ni'mah can remain for you, so you can have it. Allah also said subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا قَرْيَةً كَانَتْ آمِنَةً مُطْمَئِنَّةً يَأْتِيهَا رِزْقُهَا رَغَدًا مِنْ كُلِّ مَكَانٍ فَكَفَرَتْ بِأَنْعُمِ اللَّهِ فَأَذَاقَهَا اللَّهُ لِبَاسَ الْجُوعِ وَالْخَوْفِ بِمَا كَانُوا يَصْنَعُونَ. Allah says, I give an example of a qariyah. This qariyah is Mecca. Allah is saying to you, I'm giving you an example of this place, Mecca. ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا. And this can be used for many Muslim places around the world today. Allah gave him what? قَرْيَةً كَانَتْ آمِنَةً, safety. مُطْمَئِنَّةً, tranquility. Blessings. يَأْتِيهَا رِزْقُهَا رَغَدًا مِنْ كُلِّ مَكَانٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessing came to them from all directions. Food, everything that they wanted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He brought it to them from where? From all directions. They were getting rizq, provision. فَكَفَرَتْ, they changed. Allah didn't change giving them that blessing. Allah did not stop providing for them. Allah did not stop making their land safe for them. But when they came with this, so you underline this when you read the ayah, فَكَفَرَتْ بِأَنْعُمِ اللَّهِ, they were done kufranu ni'mah. They did not thank for Allah the ni'mah that He gave them. They didn't worship him. They didn't come with that which he ordered them to do. They did not stay away from that which he told them to stay away from. What did they Allah do? فَأَذَاقَهَ اللَّهُ لِبَاسَ الْجُوعِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dressed them. Libas, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred to it because the poverty, the ju' and the khawf صارت ملازمة لهم. It became something that was continuously with them. The way your clothes is always with you. The hunger and the anarchy and the corruption, it became something that was continuous, no stopping. Allah then mentions why this happened. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَأَذَاقَهَ اللَّهُ لِبَاسَ الْجُوعِ وَالْخَوْفِ بِمَا كَانُوا يَصْنَعُونَ Because of that which they used to do. These are examples that are in the Quran, brothers and sisters. This is why you see around the world, إِشْعَالُ النَّارِ الْفِتْنَةِ The fire of fitna occurring everywhere. Every Muslim land, there's a problem and something occurring. This is the example and this is the reason. When the people went against Allah's command, and they went against that which Allah ordered them, and that which they did, which is to oppress one another. اِعْتِدَاءَ بَعْضِهِمْ بَعْضًا Group of them started to transgress on others. Tribalism started to be used. فَأَذَاقَهَ اللَّهُ لِبَاسَ الْجُوعِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bought them a garment of poverty, and a garment of fear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, brothers, in another ayah in the Quran, قال الله تعالى Allah said وَأَن لَوْ اسْتَقَامُوا عَلَى الطَّرِيقَةِ If they were steadfast upon the path لَأَسْقَيْنَاهُمْ We would have provided for them مَاءً غَدَقًا Water that has big spots, big form of water. Meaning we would have given them rizq and provision that is wasi'. قال ابن كثير رحمه الله Ibn Kathir said on this ayah in his tafsir, he said وَأَن لَوْ اسْتَقَامُوا عَلَى الطَّرِيقَةِ هَذَا مِنْ قَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى He said, أي لَوْ آمَنَ هَؤُلَاءِ الْكُفَارِ If these disbelievers were to believe in Allah, لَوَسَعْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا We would have opened for them this dunya. وَلَبَسَطْنَا لَهُمْ فِي الرِّزْقِ And in the rizq, the provision, Allah said, we would have made it big for them. They would have got a good life. But they had to come with what? They had to believe in us. They had to worship us alone. But that was not found in them. Allah did not do that for them. He didn't open the rizq for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in another ayah, وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ If the people of the book, the Christians and the Jews, آمَنُوا They believed in Allah. وَاتَّقَوْا And they came with taqwa. لَكَفَرْنَا عَنْهُمْ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ We would have expiated for them their sins. وَلَأَدْخَلْنَاهُمْ And we would have entered them. جَنَّاتِ النَّعِيمِ Jannah that is full of blessings, greatness. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ And if only they, أَقَامُوا التَّوْرَاتَ They were to establish the book they had, which was the Torah, and which is the Jews. And the Yahud were to establish, the Christians were to establish the Injil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ Some of the Mufassirin said, the Quran, if they were to take all three of that, Allah says, لَأَكَلُوا They would have eaten. مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ From the top, Allah would have sent rain for them. For them to have. وَمِنْ تَحْتِ أَرْجُلِهِمْ And from beneath their feet, Allah would bring crops that rain would be able to produce. مِنْهُمْ Allah then said, from those people were أُمَّةٌ مُقْتَصِدَةٌ And people who middled. وَكَثِيرٌ مِنْهُمْ سَاءَ مَا يَعْمَلُونَ And a lot of them, what evil did they do? Brothers, put your eyes and your mind on this verse. Allah is saying, subhanahu wa ta'ala, for me to give them the provision, for me to look after them, for me to open risk for them in this world, what was needed for them is, they had to believe. They had to come with iman and taqwa. And what was also needed for them? They had to come, iqamatu shari'a shari'atillah, that they establish the sharia, the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in their households, and in their communities, in wherever they are. They establish Allah's religion, subhanahu wa ta'ala. What will happen? Allah says, لَأَكَلُوا مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ From the top, Allah will bring rain that will not stop, that they could have whenever they want. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that rain will not just drop and be a punishment, because sometimes the rain can be a punishment. But that rain is a rain sent for what reason? Blessing for the ummah. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah said in this ayah, لو أنهم آمنوا, if they were to believe, بالله, if they were to believe in Allah, ورسوله, and they were to believe in His Messenger, واتقوا, and they were to fear, ما كانوا يتعاطون من المحارم, if they were to fear that which they were trading, that was prohibited from them, they were to fear it and stay away from it, and the haram in which they speak amongst themselves, لكفرنا عنهم سيئاتهم, we would have expiated for them their sins, ولأدخلناهم جنات النعيم, and we would have entered them into Jannah. أي, Ibn Kathir said, لأزلنا عنهم المحذورة, we would have pushed away from them in this world harmful things, nothing harmful would come to them, ولحصلناهم المقصود, and the intent that they wanted, Allah would be able to, He would make it possible for them to obtain it. Allahu Akbar. Malik, Auf ibn Malik al-Ashja'i, this great companion, he said, one day I was with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَنَظَرَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, he looked at the sky, عليه الصلاة والسلام. And then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he then said, هَذَا أَوَانُ يُرْفَعُ الْعِلْمِ, this is the time when knowledge will be uplifted. فَقَالَ لَهُ رَجُلٌ مِّنَ الْأَنصَارِ, a man from the people of Ansar. The people of Ansar were the people who lived in Medina that the Prophet migrated to. A man from the people of Ansar, whose name was called Ziyad ibn Labid, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said to the Prophet, when the Prophet uttered these words and he was sitting, he saw the Prophet look at the sky, and then the Prophet said, هَذَا أَوَانُ يُرْفَعُ الْعِلْمِ, this is the time when knowledge is going to be uplifted. He was sitting. So he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كَيْفَ يُرْفَعُ الْعِلْمِ, how will knowledge be uplifted? How will it be uplifted? وَقَدْ أَثْبَتَ, and knowledge has become solidified in us, meaning we memorized the book. In another riwayah he said, Ziyad ibn Labid, this companion, in another narration, he said, how is it that it's going to be lifted from us, O Messenger of Allah? وَفِينَا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ, and the book of Allah is present with us. وَقَدْ عَلَّمْنَا أَبْنَاءَنَا, we taught our children, وَفَتَيَاتِنَا, and our daughters. How is it possible that the knowledge can be uplifted when the book of Allah is present amongst us? And then there are our children who've memorized it, we've made them memorize it. How could the knowledge be uplifted? The Prophet then said to him, ثَكِلَتْكَ أُمُّكَ يَا لَبِيدٍ, يَا زِيَادٍ, Ziyad, may your mother lose you. It is an Arab saying. It doesn't mean anything bad. He said, I used to think, the Prophet said, إِن كُنْتُ لَأَحْسَبُكَ, I used to add you and I used to assume, أَنَّكَ مِنْ أَفْقَهِ أَهْلِ الْمَدِينَةِ, I used to believe that you were the most knowledgeable person, one of the most knowledgeable people in Medina, for you to ask me this question. أَوَلَيْسَتِ التَّوْرَاتِ, wasn't the Torah, the book the Jews have, wal Injil, and the book of the Christians, was it not bad al-Yahud wal-Nasara, was it not in their hands? فَمَا أَغْنَى عَنْهُمْ, it did not benefit them. حِينَ تَرَكُوا أَمْرَ اللَّهِ, when they left the Lord, when they left the command of their Lord. So some of us today, we have made the Quran things that are stuck on the wall, ayat from the Quran. And we took the Mus'haf and we put it on somewhere very high. And that's all it is. But not one verse from the Qur'an do we implement. The time when the Qur'an will be uplifted, the Masahif will be there. But then what will be taken is it? It isn't the rasm of the Qur'an, isn't the written. Rather, brothers, it's the action that is being taken from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ikhwani, there are examples in the Qur'an that point these issues. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, لَقَدْ كَانَ لِسَبَئٍ فِي مَسْكَنِهِمْ آيَةٍ جَنَّتَانِ عَنْ يَمِينِ وَشِمَالٍ. Bring me a mushaf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did he say? لَقَدْ كَانَ لِسَبَئٍ فِي مَسْكَنِهِمْ آيَةٍ جَنَّتَانِ عَنْ يَمِينِ وَشِمَالٍ كُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِ رَبِّكُمْ وَاشْكُرُوا لَهُ بَلْدَةٌ طَيِّبَةٌ وَرَبٌّ غَفُورٌ فَأَعْرَضُوا فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِمِ وَبَدَّلْنَاهُمْ بِجَنَّتَيْهِمْ جَنَّتَيْنِ ذَوَاتَيْ أُكُلٍ خَمْطٍ وَأَثْلٍ وَشَيْءٍ مِنْ سِدْرٍ قَلِيلٍ ذَلِكَ جَزَيْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَفَرُوا فَهَلْ نُجَازِي إِلَّا الْكَفُورِ فَأَعْرَضُوا. Allah says there's a story here. Allah says there's a story here. لَقَدْ كَانَ لِسَبَأ, the people of Sheba. The people of Sabah are a people who are now, if we look at the current way the world is made today, it's based in Yemen, a place called Ma'rab. And it's the people who hoodhood, the bird hoodhood. When it came to Nabiullah Sulaiman, he said, "Inni tarak inni." I have left a people. I found a people worshipping the sun. Besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hudhud said, إِنِّي وَجَدْتُ امْرَأَةً تَمْلِكُهُمْ وَأُوْتِيَتْ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَلَهَا عَرْشٌ عَظِيمٌ يَعْبُدُونَ لِلشَّمْسِ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ وَزَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ وَعَمَالَهُمْ فَصَدَّهُمْ عَنِ السَّبِيلِ فَهُمْ لَا يَهْتَدُونَ. I left a people who were worshipping the sun. Shaytan had beautified their righteous actions for them. And they are not the people who are going to take guidance. Hudhud, this is the reason why she was away. These were the people of Saba. Allah says in Surah Saba, a whole surah He named after them. He said, لَقَدْ كَانَ لِسَبَى. The people of Saba, there's a remarkable story in their life that we should ponder on. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? لَقَدْ كَانَ لِسَبَءٍ فِي مَسْكَنِهِمْ جَنَّتَانِ عَنْ يَمِينِ وَشِمَالِ. There was a garden that they had. One was placed on the right and one was on the left. جَنَّتَانِ عَنْ يَمِينِ وَشِمَالِ. Allah said to them, كُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِ رَبِّكُمْ وَشْكُرُوا لَهُ. All that which is in your gardens, eat it. You know when you're told this is all halal for you, it's a blessing. And that nothing is prohibited from you. All that which you see is halal, eat it. لكن وَشْكُرُوا لَهُ. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what He gave you. بَلْدَةٌ طَيِّبَةٌ. Your land is a blessed land. وَرَبٌّ. And you have a Lord that is forgiving. This is what you have. This is to point out the point that I'm talking about today, which is تَصْفِيَةُ الْأَحْوَالِ بِتَصْفِيَةِ الْأَعْمَالِ. If we want our situations to change, we have to change our actions. Look what the people of Saba did. What did they say? All this blessing that they had, they should have thanked Allah for it. So the ni'mah could remain for them, the blessing could still continue. What did they do? Allah says, فَعَرَضُوا. They turned away. فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِمِ. And because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, we sent down to them a rain that destroyed their land. We sent for them creatures that went into their gardens, and everything that you saw that was green, it turned out to be something else. فَعَرَضُوا. But who did it first? They turned away. فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِمِ وَبَدَّلْنَاهُمْ بِجَنَّتَيْهِمْ. The two jannah they had. جَنَّتَيْنِ ذَوَاتَيْ أُكُلِ الْخَمْضِ وَأَثْرٍ وَشَيْءٍ مِنْ سِدْرٍ قَلِيلٍ. ذَلِكَ جَزَيْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَفَرُوا. Everyone who disbelieves in us, the blessing that we give them. Here the kufr can be two types. Kufr al-ni'ma, the person who the blessing is given and he doesn't thank Allah for it. How is it that you don't thank Allah for it? You don't thank Him with it with your tongue. You don't also thank Him with what? Your limbs. Because before that, the ayat before that in Surah Saba, what did He say? اعملوا آل داود شكرا وقليل من عبادي الشكور. Oh, the people of Dawood, come with shukr on your limbs. So the shukr occurs on the limbs as well. That when Allah blesses you with something, and Allah gives you health, and Allah gives you a good life, that you are a person who prays to Him. Because you know what He has given you, He deserves for you to thank Him back with it. This is not what they did. They started to worship the sun. They started to turn away from the tawheed and the monotheism that they should have been upon. So what did Allah do? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, one of the blessings that they had, وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنَهُمْ وَبَيْنَ الْقُرَى الَّتِي بَارَكْنَا فِيهَا قُرًا ظَاهِرَةً وَقَدَّرْنَا فِيهَا السَّيْرَ سِيرُ فِيهَا لَيَالِيَ وَأَيَّامًا آمِنِينَ. They had two things. If they used to trade from Yemen and they used to go to Sham. Whenever they went from Yemen and they would walk, they would be cities after cities and villages after villages. It wasn't as though they were traveling. They felt like they were just walking inside a city. Allah made the whole land so short for them. Plus, Allah gave them safety to their place that they were going. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? Allah tells us at the end of the ayah, وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَحَادِيثًا وَمَزَّقْنَاهُمْ كُلَّ مُمَزَّقٍ وَمَزَّقْنَاهُمْ كُلَّ مُمَزَّقٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, we ripped their affairs up. And we made them an example for those to come later to read on them. How their situation changed. When the people don't read the Quran and they don't go back to these people's affairs, they will be amazed. Why is why are the Muslims suffering like this? Why are they going through these problems? The Ummah are going through it because of fa'aradu, they turned away. Another ayah in the Quran, or verses in the Quran, that I want our minds to come to it. And there are a lot of brothers and sisters in the book of Allah. Allah mentions in Surah Al-Qalam, a story of a father. Surah Al-Qalam. And I'm not going to bring examples from nowhere else except the Quran and Sunnah and the understanding of the pious predecessors. That's enough for us. Allah is in Surah Al-Qalam about a father who had a garden. This father was a righteous man. And whenever his wealth would reach the time for the zakat to be paid, he used to follow the command of Allah, وَآتُوا حَقَّهُ يَوْمَ حَصَادِ. When your wealth reaches its nisab and its timing, give the zakat from it. He used to do this. But the father died. He left some of his kids behind. They changed from what their father was upon. Allah tells us their story in the Quran. Allah says, Inna balawnahum kama balawna ashab al jannati id aqsamu la yasrimunnaha musbihin wa la yastathnun. This is what they did. At night, before they went to sleep, their father, what he used to do is whenever he wanted to take the crops and the garden, he would make sure that the poor were around in order for them to see him taking it so they can take their parts. He wouldn't do it with their absence. That's the type of person he was. But these children, they said, we will do all this whilst the poor people are not around. We're going to change the situation. We're not going to do it how our father used to do it. We're not going to give nothing to them. So what happened? They said, this is going to happen. Whilst they were sleeping, فَطَافَ عَلَيْهَا طَائِفٌ مِّن رَبِّكَ وَهُمْ نَائِمُونَ. They planned and Allah plans. Whilst they were sleeping at night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent for them something that burnt their garden. فَأَصْبَحَتْ كَالصَّرِيمِ. It became like black pitch. The green grasses, those fruits and those vegetables that were on it, all of it is now gone. Burnt it down to the ground, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They woke up in the morning amongst themselves. What did they say? أَنِغْدُوا عَلَى حَرْثِكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَارِيمِينَ فَانْطَغْلَقُوا وَهُمْ يَتَخَافَتُونَ أَلَّا يَدْخُلَنَّهَا الْيَوْمَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِسْكِينَ. No miskin is going to enter our garden today. We're going to take it. So that, what did they want to do? At night time, they wanted to take it because they didn't want the poor to see it. So what happened when they came and they laid their eyes on it and they saw it? فَلَمَّا رَأُوهَا. When they laid eyes on the garden and they saw how Allah destroyed it the night before. قَالُوا إِنَّا We are the one that are the ضالين. We are the misguided ones. They recognized what they did. Allah destroyed their garden from them. بَلْ نَحْنُ مَحْرُومُونَ. Rather, we are the one that are prohibited from this garden, not the misakin. It's us that is taken away from. Ikhwani, this is another example from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying that when they changed the situation that their father was upon, when they turned away from it, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do to them? Allah changed their situation. If you today go back and you read the history of what happened to a lot of the Muslim countries, you read the history of how it happened, you will realize that land, the sins, how it was like. How bribery was being implemented. I went to some places in the Muslim land, Muslim countries, that for a man to let his beard grow, he had to get a certificate from the government. Official letter to let his beard grow. He had to bring a paper from the government. You could not take one step bribery. You have to pay rishwa all day to get through everything. Your own haq, your own rights, you can't get it because of this. The zina, the homosexuality, it spread. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's punishment comes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُصِيبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاصًا. The fitna, when it comes, is not only going to hit the ones that did the wrong. أَبَدًا لَا. Wallahi won't. Wallahi won't. That fitna, when it comes, it's going to destroy every single person who's in that land, even the righteous people, because the sin is more than the righteous people. So the minority get burnt down with the majority. The battle of Uhud, when the Sahabas, Ridwanullah alayhim ajma'in, they lost in the fight. They disobeyed the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's command, one command. They disobeyed. How much do we disobey? Millions. Just one time he said, do not come down from this mountain. Stay on it. Remain steadfast. Even if you see me, Messenger of Allah, and my companions, the birds eating us, dead, don't even come for us. Stay there. 50 men he put on that mountain. When they came down, who suffered with them? Even the Prophet did. Shujja ra'su wa kusirat ruba'iyatu. His head was wounded, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his helmet went, and the helmet went into his mouth, alayhi salatu wa sallam, and his tooth broke, alayhi salatu wa sallam. When Allah's punishment comes, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's destruction comes, it won't, this righteous people cannot stop anything. That's why the righteous people, they stop the wrongdoers at the beginning. Or fear people, what you're doing is wrong. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what you're saying is wrong. What you're acting is wrong. Because if you don't, we're all going to suffer. We're all on one boat together. If one person goes and he makes a hole inside the boat, we're all going to sink. So if that dim-witted one wants to break a hole inside the boat, aren't we all going to stop him? If we don't, we all die with him. This is the reality of the matter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, how will the Muslims earn their honor that they once had, brothers? How will they regain it? How could they have it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we made from them, meaning Reban Israel, we made from them leaders. We made them leaders from them when two conditions were found in them. What is it? لَمَّا صَبَرُوا, when they were patient. Patience in three ways, brothers. Patience from the sins. Patience upon the obedience. And patience upon that which Allah has destined for you, for it to take place in your life. When those three patience you, is found in you. And the second part is, so the first was patient. And the second was what? وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. Certainty. That the true religion is the deen of Islam. There is no other religion that is greater than Islam. هُوَ دِينُ الْحَقِّ. It is the true religion. That if the person holds on to it, he will not find in this world humiliation nor in the hereafter. He looks for honor in that which he is certain about, which is the book of Allah. How could you claim تَعْصِيلْ إِلَاهَ وَأَنْتَ تَزْعُمُ حُبَّهُ هَذَا لَعَمْرُكَ فِي الْقِيَاسِ سَنِيعُ لَوْ كَانَ حُبُّكَ صَادِقًا لَأَطَعْتُهُ إِنَّ الْمُحِبَّ لِمَنْ يُحِبُّ مُطِيعُ. You claim you love the messenger. You claim you love Allah. And then when we look at your actions, when we look at the way you talk, when we look at the way you act, it has no connection with that which the Prophet was. And you disobey him in everything of your life. You claim that you are certain that what he said is the truth. But then we see that you oppose him in everything. We see you say that the true religion is Islam, but you don't act. You do not take from it nothing. That is a claim that everyone can claim, brothers and sisters. Wa alaikum salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he told us in another ayah. ولذلك شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله used to say بالصبر واليقين تنال الإمامة في الدين. With patience and certainty, you will obtain and you will gain leadership. When these two characteristics are found in anyone, Allah makes them a leader. He makes that nation, those people, gain the best position in the world. But when those two are missing from them, they lose. Today the Muslims don't have certainty of their own religion. His question is religion. Is Islam a true religion? If we are, why is Allah destroying us like this for? One simple question. This morning, did you pray Salatul Fajr in Jama'ah? The answer is no. How do you want Allah to uplift the Ummah from this problem that they're in? When you left your house this morning and you wanted to do your, what was in your mind? To obtain the worldly affairs and you had no religious goal? Or was it, why did you leave your house for this morning? Worldly. And then you want Allah to uplift from the ummah the humiliation and the destruction that they're in. Allah doesn't, subhanahu wa ta'ala, change a people's situation until they change their actions. Whilst we are Muslims acting like this and we're being like this, Allah will not uplift this from us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in another ayah, وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْقُرَىٰ, if the people of the city and the village and the towns, آمَنُوا, they believed in Allah, وَاتَّقَوْ, and they had piety, was found in them. لَفَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَرَكَاتٍ مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ. Allah says, blessings will be opened for them from the samawat. وَالْأَرْضِ, and this earth. وَلَكِنْ كَذَّبُوا, but they disbelieve. وَلَكِنْ كَذَّبُوا, Allah says, they disbelieve. فَأَخَذْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. And Allah says, we hold them account for that which they have come with. We don't want to believe the way we should do. ولذلك حسن البصري he said الإيمان ليس بالتحلي ولا بالتمني ولكنه ما وقر في القلب وصدقته العمل. Iman isn't a claim. Because if everything is a claim, I can claim, and you can claim, and he can claim, and he can claim. Every one of us here, can we claim? الدعوة ما لم تقيم ببينات أبناؤها الدعياء. Everyone can claim, brothers. Claim is the most easiest thing. But it's the fact that you can show what you believe. And you can prove it. It's based in your heart. The Iman has touched your heart. And then it comes, the athar, and the outcomes, the results are found in your limbs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he also said in another ayah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ قُلْ say to them, O Muhammad, يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ the people of the books, لَسْتُمْ عَلَى شَيْءٍ you are upon nothing. You are upon nothing. حَتَّى تُقِيمَ التَّوْرَاتِ until you establish Tawrat and you establish the Injil. What was said to them is also said to us. We are upon nothing. We mean nothing. In the eyes of Allah, we have no weight if we don't establish what? The Book of Allah. If we don't establish the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we are nothing. We have no meaning whatsoever. ولذلك the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith, Abu Dawud narrated in his Sunan min hadithi Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu ta'ala an, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he said, إذا تبايعتم بالعينة وأخذتم أذناب البقر وأخذتم أذناب البقر ورضيتم بالزرع وتركتم الجهاد سلط الله عليكم ذلا لا ينزع لا يرفع عنكم حتى ترجعوا إلى دينكم. He said, إذا تبايعتم بالعينة. Ina is a form of riba. And the Prophet said, إِذَا تَبَايَعْتُمْ مَا مَنَا تَبَايَعْتُمْ if you trade one another with riba. Riba, Ina is a form of riba. And it's the form which involves. If a person gives you £100 as a debt, and tomorrow he says to you, I want from you, instead of the £100 that I gave you, I want 120. That £20 is riba, clear-cut. You can see it, right? It's riba. So he won't do that. He will bring business into it. So what would he say? He will say, you have to buy this product for me. So when you buy that product from him, later what will happen is the product will come back to the owner again and you will end up be paying £120. And there's always that 20. That's £20 extra that he's going to make. It's what? It's when tahayul, when people start to play around with Allah's sharia, try to find excuses and reasonings for it. A man divorces his wife. 3 divorces he gives to her. It finishes. He has nothing more left for him. He goes to another man and says, marry my wife for me. So then she can come back to me with 3 more left. This is what? It's tahallul. It is not permissible. All these type of tradings and all this is haram, we find another back door for it. When the ummah start to do that, إِذَا تَبَايَعْتُمْ بِالْعِينَ وَأَخَذْتُمْ أَذْنَابَ الْبَقَرِ and you take the tail of, you mean you follow the world. وَرَضِيتُمْ بِالزَّرْعِ and you become pleased with the world. وَتَرَكْتُمُ الْجِهَادَ and you leave off jihad. Whether it's jihadun nafs, which is the most important one. Fighting with yourself first. Establishing an Islamic government in where? In yourself. In your household. Where you live. First jihad. And also the second form of jihad. The ummah don't leave those two. Except Allah will place over them what? Humiliation. ذُل. And will Allah lift that humiliation from the ummah? Allah said, the Prophet said, Allah will not lift it from them until they come back to حَتَّى تَرْجِعُوا إِلَى دِينِكُمْ until you come back to your religion. In another riwayah, Tabarani narrated, حَتَّى تَرْجِعُوا إِلَى أَمْرِ الْأَوَّلِ until you come back to the first affairs that the Sahabas were upon. So the religion that we need to come back to is what religion? The religion we've made, the 21st century religion, that we've now modified and we've changed and we, you know, we put what we wanted into it and took whatever we wanted from it? Or is the religion that we need to come with the religion that the Sahabatul Kiram radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in were upon? That's the religion that we need to be upon. That's the religion that's going to uplift us. That's what uplifted them, the companions. That's what gave them honor in this world and in the hereafter. That's how they gained Jannah in the hereafter and in this world. The whole world was under their what? It was under their fist. They were controlling it like that. Bedouins who didn't even know these kind of stuff, weren't exposed to that lifestyle. But they took over when they submitted themselves to Allah the way they should. And they did not become as we've become. أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهَهُ هَوَاهُ. Do you not see those who have taken Allah, their desires? They worship their desires. How do they worship their desires? Their desire tells them to do something and they follow it. When Allah tells it to them, I need to look into it, I can't do it. He has 50 excuses for it. But when his nafs is inclined to this matter, the minute his nafs wants to do it, he's going to do it. This is the type of people we are, sahih? Will Allah uplift from us the humiliation that we're in? Are we today, as we are, as Muslims, are we humiliated? Wherever we are, na'am wallah we are. Will Allah uplift it from us? Will that humiliation be uplifted from us by screaming and shouting? Will that humiliation be uplifted from us going to Trafalgar Square, demonstrating and taking billboards? Will that uplift a humiliation from us? Will it? And then we go home and say, I did good for the deen. Will that uplift it from us? La wallahi won't. It wallahi didn't for the pious predecessors, and wallahi won't do it for us. Hatta tarji'u ila deenukum. Go back to your religion. تَرْجُ النَّجَاةَ وَلَمْ تَسْلُكْ مَسَالِكَهَا إِنَّ سَفِينَةَ لَا تَجْرِ عَلَى الْيَبْسِ. A person wants to say to you, he has a boat, and he wants to tell you that he wants to take a shortcut on his boat. He's got a boat. So he says, I want to go down there, it's close. So he pulls his boat on top of the shore. Well, the boat does not go on the shore, the boat goes on the sea. You have to take the road for it, there's no other way for it. Success is only one way. Don't make your own roads to success, there isn't. It's only one way. In order to obtain it, we've been told, حَتَّى تَرْجِعُوا إِلَىٰ دِينِكُمْ. Until you come back to your religion, we will not leave this humiliation. Have we tried demonstration? Did it work for us? It hasn't worked for us. One, have we tried shouting and screaming and crying? Have we tried to speak to all politicians? Have we tried all of this? Have we tried to do partitions that we wrote it and we signed it? Have we done all of that? Yaqom, answer the question. Have we done all of this? Has it worked for us? And wallahi, it won't work. And the reason I say wallahi, it won't work is my Prophet, who I trust in everything, who came to me. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا بَعَثَ اللَّهُ نَبِيًّا. Allah did not send a Prophet. إِلَّا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ Except it was upon that Prophet, أَن يَدُلَّ أُمَّتَهُ عَلَى خَيْرِ مَا يَعْلَمُهُ اللَّهُ. It was upon that Prophet to convey to his people the good that he knows. And there did not come a Prophet unless he was ordered to tell his people the harm that could come to them and how to stay away from that harm. My Prophet did that. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, لَقَدْ تُوُفْيَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Our Messenger Muhammad died. وَمَا مِن طَائِرٍ. And there was not a bird that flapped its wing in the sky. إِلَّا أَخْبَرَ لَنَا مِنْهُ عِلْمًا. Except he told us a knowledge regarding it. Everything our religion was told. Salman al-Farisi, a man came to him. He said, أَخْبَرَكُمْ نَبِيُّكُمْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. Did your Prophet tell you everything? He said, yes, he did. He said, even al-Khira. بِمَعْنَى. How to do our call of nature. The Prophet that told us how to do call of nature. أَلَّا نَسْتَقْبِلَ الْقِبْلَةَ وَأَلَّا نَسْتَدْبِرَ الْقِبْلَةَ. That we don't face the Qibla when we do our call of nature. And that we do not turn our backs towards the Qibla. And that we do not use less than 3 stones. And that, will he tell us that? And then not come and tell us about how we can stay away from destruction and harm? La wallahi, it was impossible. And our Messenger told us. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that we will have a humiliation. And what will take us out of that humiliation? The coming back to that religion. Every person, don't point your finger at anyone. Wallahi, don't. Everyone has a fair share in this matter. You go home and play your part in making sure that your household, the wife that you leave behind in the house, the children that you leave behind, yourself, Islam is established in your household. First of all. And if everyone does that responsibility, takes it for us, وَلِلَّهِ الْحَمْدُ وَالْمِنَّةِ, the next Muslim ruler will come from one of those houses, and inshallah khair will come. And khayr will come. Abu Sulaiman al-Darani, from the A'immatu al-Tabi'in, from the A'immatu al-Salaf al-Salih, he said, Man safa sufiya lah. Anyone who purifies his situation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will change his condition for him. Allahu Akbar. وَمَنْ كَدَّرَ كُدِّرَ عَلَيْهِ. And anyone who taints his matter, he taints his actions, he doesn't come with what he should do, he stays away from the orders of Allah, and he falls into the prohibitions, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will destroy him. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنَ فِي لَيْلِهِ. Anyone who works hard at his night, meaning when the people are sleeping, at night he stands up and he begs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All these people today that seem to be saddened about the reality of the Muslims, how much really of them stand at night for the sake of Allah and make dua for these people? Because we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the messenger told us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَنْزِلُ فِي ثُلُثُ اللَّيْلِ الْأَخِيرِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends. And then Allah, what does He say to His servant? Who is going to ask me for that which He wants, and I will give it to him? وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِي إِذَا دَعَانِ. Allah is the one that accepts the dua of His caller. So who really stands up and asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at this time? Who perfects his night? Sulaiman al-Darani said, who is the person who perfects his night except what happens? كُوفِئَ فِي نَهَارِهِ. Except the daytime, Allah will protect his daytime for him. Allah will take over your affairs for you. Also, what did he say? وَمَنْ أَحْسَنَ فِي نَهَارِ. And anyone who works hard for his daytime, he makes sure that the daytime, whatever he is doing, he makes sure he fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the food that goes into his mouth. أَيُّ لَحْمٍ نَبَتَتْ عَلَىٰ حَرَامٍ فَالنَّارُ بِهِ أَوْلَىٰ. Any person who eats haram, the hellfire has a right on you the day of judgment. Come, how much of us say, you know, by all means necessary, I have to do this job. What can I do? You know, I'm forced into it. It's not my choice. Kadhab. But when it comes to your affairs of the hereafter, I can't do it. You're slow. But when it comes to the disobedience of Allah, you're the first to fall into it. What are you, we need to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to fear Allah. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, رجل يطيل السفر أشعث أغبر يمد يديه إلى السماء يا رب ومطعمه حرام وملبسه حرام وغضي بالحرام فأنا يستجاب له. The Prophet told us, a man who was a traveler. This is why we even if we did stand at night and we did make dua, Allah, a lot of us won't accept our duas. Why? Because all day we're eating haram. And all night we're doing sinful acts. And so what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do to our affairs? Allah had left us, He's forsaken us, abandoned us, and He said, control your own affairs. Because you don't ask me for anything. You don't worship me as your creator. This man, the Prophet told us, was a traveler. What from the people whose du'as are accepted are who? The traveler. ثَلَاثَةٌ دُعَاهُمْ لَا تُرَدْ. Three people's du'as are never rejected. They're accepted. From them is the what? The traveler. He lifted his hands up in the air. Not only did he lift his hands up, the Prophet said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَيِّيٌّ كَرِيمٌ إِذَا رَفَعَ إِلَيْهِنْ عَبْدٌ يَدَهِ لَمْ يَدْرُدْهُمَا صِفْرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what? حَيِّي. Allah is shy. كَرِيم. Allah is generous. No servant lifts his hands up in the air except Allah gives him what he asks for. This man, he did it. So he was a traveler and he also lifted his hands up. Listen to me, brothers. The third thing, what did he do? He said, Ya Rab, Ya Rab. If you go to Surah Ali Imran, when the people said, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, what did Allah say after that? The last safha in Surah Ali Imran, the last page. فَاسْتَجَبْنَا. We accepted their dua. Because they used so much Ya Rab. Ya Rab is one of the ways to Allah to accept your dua. Because there is in it what? تُلِحُ فِي الدُعَائِكِ. You are excessive, you're begging Allah. Allah will accept it from you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He came with those three. Allah didn't accept his dua. Why? His condition cannot be changed for him because his actions were not accordingly. So when he said, Ya Rab, he cried to his Lord as a traveler. He needs him. He's in the desert. He's in time of trouble. He cried back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did the Prophet say? Mat'amu haram. His food is haram. Wa malbasuhu haram. The clothes that he's probably wearing is haram. He got it from a haram income. Wa wudiya bil haram. And he was raised upon haram. فأنا يستجاب له. How is his dua going to be accepted? How is dua going to be accepted? Abdullah ibn Mubarak, I was reading the Sirah Alam al-Nubala by Imam al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah. He mentions Abdullah ibn Mubarak. He was from the A'immatul Nuqad. He was from the great scholars of hadith. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, his father, Mubarak, used to be a slave for a man. He used to be a slave for a man. The man said to him one day, go into the garden that I own and said, go get me the most juiciest, the most tastiest apple that I have in my garden. Go get it for me. And Abdullah ibn Mubarak's father went and he got a couple of apples and he brought it to the man. He said, here it is. He took a bite and he said, I asked you the most tasty, the most nicest apple of the in the garden. He said, wallahi, I've never eaten any of your products in this garden ever. I don't know what they taste like. I just took the chance and I brought you which I thought could be nice. He gave birth to who? Abdullah ibn Mubarak. You see, the halal person whose income is halal, whose life is halal, whose situation is good, Allah will bring good out of him. This is the problem that we have. We're not looking into the matters as it should be. Fudayl ibn Iyad said, rahimahullah rahmatan wasa'ah. He said, inni la'a'si Allah. I disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Azza wa jal. Fa'a'rifu thalika fi khuluqi dabati wa jariyati. I disobey Allah. And when I come home, I find the disobedience in who? My riding beast. My beast doesn't want to listen to me anymore. I tell him to go right, he wants to go left. He doesn't listen to me. My slave girl, I tell her what to do. She's a bit hard-headed. She doesn't want to listen to me. My children, I tell them what to do. They don't listen to me. My wife, I tell her to do something. She doesn't listen to me. It's because I did something wrong. Who do they blame? We want to blame who? We want to blame society. We want to blame other people. And because the person is not rectified, not knowing that his situation, he won't be able to rectify it. When I disobey Allah, I see that in who? In my wife and my children. I see that in my household. So whenever your family are not listening to you, sit down and ask yourself one question. How are you as an individual to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What do you do with Allah's commands subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do you follow it as it is? And this brings me to the last point of our talk, bi-idhnillah al-kareem, which is, what are the reasons why the ummah, a nation, can be humiliated? What is the reasons? The asbabul inhizam, that Allah puts a nation down, a people, especially Muslims who have once gained honor and respect. And read the biography on the tariq and the tarajum and the books that have been written in this matter, you will see so much that will fascinate you, how Muslims were like. There were lands that we took over without no swords, no guns, no nothing. Just our good character and the good righteous actions that we had. We just opened the people's hearts and they accepted us in their countries. This is how Islam was. This is how Muslims were. One of the first things, brothers, that an ummah will gain humiliation is because muhadatillahi wa rasuli. When the people oppose Allah and His Messenger and they'll go against His commands, humiliation will fall on those people. Give those people a short time and watch what they end up to become. Allah says that in the Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُحَادُّونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ أُولَٰئِكَ فِي الْأَذَلِّينَ. Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ the ones يُحَادُّونَ اللَّهَ who are opposing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who are going against His commands, who are fighting against Him subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ فِي الْأَذَلِّينَ. Those people are from the humiliated, degraded people. There's no other humiliation than a person who goes against Allah and His Messenger. However much he claims honor and however much he claims greatness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said about Nabiullah Ibrahim, فَأَرَادُوا بِهِ كَيْدًا فَجَعَلْنَاهُمُ الْأَسْفَلِينَ. They wanted to harm him. فَأَرَادُوا بِهِ, they wanted for him كَيْدًا. They plotted against Nabiullah Ibrahim. فَأَرَادُوا بِهِ كَيْدًا. And because Ibrahim gave himself into Allah. قال الله تعالى ومن يرغب عن ملة إبراهيم إلا من سفه نفسه ولقد اصطفيناه في الدنيا وإنه في الآخرة لمن الصالحين إذ قال له ربه أسلم قال أسلمت لرب العالمين ووصى بها إبراهيم بنيه ويعقوب يا بني إن الله اصطفى لكم الدين فلا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. إبراهيم, he surrendered himself to Allah. إذ قال له ربه أسلم. When Allah said to him, surrender, submit yourself to me, Ibrahim said, oh Allah, I submit myself to you. I follow whatever you want from me. And he proved that, Nabiullah Ibrahim alayhi salam. He proved his submission to Allah, that his son that he loved as an old man, his son that he loved so much, he was told to kill his son and slaughter his son. Was he not? What did Nabiullah Ibrahim do? فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعْهُ السَّعْيَ قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى. My son, I saw in a dream, a revelation from Allah, that I was told to slaughter you. What do you see? Ibrahim is going to slaughter his father. His son, sorry. He's a father who was old in age. He's a man who submitted himself to Allah. Who took who? He took Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's command as it is. His own son, his own blood and flesh, puts him down on the ground and is ready to slaughter him. He is an abdul munqad, a servant who follows the command of the one who created him. He is what the messenger said, al-mu'minu kal-jabal al-anif yaqidu haythu qad. A believer is like a camel that is held from the nose. He follows the rope, not the neck, because the neck you can pull back a bit. You can say, no, I don't want to go. But when a person puts a rope inside your nose, it's hard for you to pull back because it's the most delicate part of your face. You can't pull back. You don't want to rip your nose. The believer is like that. That when that rope is slightly pulled, what does he do? He runs after it. He, whatever direction he's pulled to, he goes. That's how a believer is. And the Sahabas, Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, this is how their lifestyle was. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in a hadith, the ayah of aradu bihi kaydan faja'alnahum al-asfaleen. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari rahimahullah, he said, al-adhalleen. The word adhalleen here means what? Adhalleen hujjatan. In their proofs, they were weak. Allah put them down, they had no proof. وَغَلَبْنَا إِبْرَاهِيمِ. And we gave the superiority, we gave the upper hand to Nabiullah Ibrahim. بِالْحُجَّةِ, with proof. He was only one person. Against a whole nation by himself. But because he surrendered himself to Allah, as a servant should do, Allah took over his affairs. And now that Allah took over his affairs, did Allah maneuver, did Allah put him in the right place? Allah gave him success. They wanted to burn him. The fire, Allah said to him, Allah spoke to the fire. What did he say to the fire? Kuni bardan wa salam ala Ibrahim. Be cold and be safe upon Ibrahim. Some of the narration mentioned that Jibreel came down and said to him, Allah has sent me down to you. Allah wants me to tell me what you want. I will do it for you. He said, I don't need you. I need Allah. He said to the angel, I don't need you at all. The one I need is Allah. Because his heart was connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Imam Bukhari rahimahullah and Imam Muslim, both of them narrated in the Sahih min Hadith Abi Hurairah that the messenger, that he said, قَالَ سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, I heard the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, مَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوا وَمَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ فَإِنَّمَا أَهْلَكَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ كَثْرَةُ مَسَائِلِهِمْ وَاخْتِلَافُهُمْ عَلَى أَنْبِيَائِهِمْ. Whatever I prohibit you from, مَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوا. Stay away from it. Look how the hadith speaks. The hadith says, whenever you're prohibited from something, stay away from it. It didn't condition ability to stay away. You don't need ability to stay away from something. But when it came to following the command, ability was connected to it. وَمَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ, and that which I ordered you, فَأْتُوا, come with it. مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ, that which you're able to do. Then the Prophet said, فَإِنَّمَا أَهْلَكَ الَّذِينَ, the ones who came before you were destroyed. Why? كَثْرَةُ مَسَائِلِهِمْ, they asked too much. Some of the shurrah, they say, they asked too much questions, and the reason of their question was they didn't want to follow the command. Such as the people of Banu Israel, when they said to Nabiullah and Musa alayhi salam, Inna Allah ya'murukum an tadbahu baqara. Allah ordered you to slaughter, wa alaykum salam. Allah ordered you to slaughter a cow. What did they do? They said, explain this cow to us. What color is it? How do you want it to look like? The questioning here was min which al-anad, al-juhud, wal-iba'i wa-stikbar. They didn't want to follow it. But what happened, they were making it even harder for themselves. Because at the beginning they had wusq, they could have taken any cow and they could have slaughtered it. But because they narrowed it down on themselves even more, it became one particular one that they had to slaughter at the end. Then the final part of the hadith, what does it say? وَاخْتِلَافُهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنْبِيَائِهِمْ. And they were opposing the command of their prophets. Ikhwani, look at the qissah of Fir'aun. Fir'aun, فَالْيَوْمَ نُنَجِّيكَ بِبَدَرِكَ لِتَكُونَ لِمَنْ خَلْفَكَ آيَةً. Fir'aun, who what he did to Musa and all the people, how he got humiliated. He's in a museum, people are watching him today. Humiliated him. You see? Look at the people Abu Jahl. And look at Sadadid Quraysh. Look at the leaders and the heads of Quraysh. The Battle of Badr, what happened to them? The Prophet took them and he threw them into Qulayb, Bi'r Qulayb. It was a well that was not used. It was water wouldn't come from it. So he threw them into it, all of their bodies. And what did he say to them? He said to them in the well, he said to them, هَلْ وَجَدْتُمْ مَا وَعَدَ رَبُّكُمْ? Have you guys found what Allah has promised you? For verily, I have found what Allah has promised me. I got it. I got the victory that I was promised. لَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرِ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّ. You were little in number in Badr. 319, 320, 300, whatever call. But little. Against that 1,000 people in number, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised me victory and I got the victory I got promised. Did you guys get what you were promised, meaning the hellfire and the last final abode? Humiliation. Opposing the Prophet and Allah, this is how humiliated you become. Bukhari said, min hadith Abi Hurairah, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, qala Allahu ta'ala, Allah said, man aada li waliyan faqad aadantuhu bil harb. Fi riwayatin, in another riwayah is, waman faqad barazani bil harb. Anyone who fights against and wages a war against my awliya, the highest of them are who? The prophets. That person has come out in a fight with Allah. Is that person not going to be humiliated? A person wants to fight with Allah. Will he make it through? Allah, he won't make it through. Be humiliated. A lot of people want to wage war against who? Allah and His Messenger. Are they going to make it through? La wallahi, they won't. They won't. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ, the ones who disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's verses, وَيَقْتُلُونَ النَّبِيِّينَ, and they kill the prophets of Allah, بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ, without the truth. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَيَقْتُلُونَ النَّبِيِّينَ, they kill the prophets, بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ, without haq? Is there a مَفْهُومُ الْمُخَالَفَةِ? Can we understand the opposite from it? Meaning there is a time when it's haq to kill the prophets? No. The Mufassirin, they say, بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ أَيْ وَهُمْ يَدْرُونَ, and they knew that they were killing them without haq. They understood that they were doing it without haq. They knew it. وَيَقْتُلُونَ الَّذِينَ, and they were killing, and they were fighting, and they were waging war against who? وَيَقْتُلُونَ الَّذِينَ يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْقِسْطِ, the ones that were ordering justice, adil, and haq, they were also killing them. فَبَشِّرْهُمْ, give those glad people who are doing that to the prophets. They want to kill the prophets. They want to kill the righteous people. They want to kill them. What do you do? Give them a glad tidings. On what? بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ, glad tidings of a severe punishment that awaits them. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ, those are the people, حَبِطَتْ أَعْمَالُهُمْ, their righteous actions, all of it has been nullified from them. فِي الدُّنْيَا, in this world, وَالْآخِرَةِ, and in the hereafter, their actions are all nullified. وَمَا لَهُمْ مِنْ نَاصِرٍ, they have no one who's going to give them victory. Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad, من حديث ابن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه, that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, بُعِثْتُ بِالسَّيْفِ, I was sent out with the sword, بَيْنَ يَدَيْ السَّاعَ, before the hour, just before the hour, حَتَّى يُعْبَدَ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ, for Allah to be worshipped alone. That's why I was brought. That was my job, he said. وَجُعِلَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ, and none be associated partners with him. وَجُعِلَ رِزْقِي تَحْتَ ذِلَّ رُمْحِ, and my provision, the Prophet's provision, was placed where? Where did the Prophet used to get his income from? The ghanaim, the spoils of war. That's where his rizq used to come from. Alayhi salatu salam. وَجُعِلَ, and it was made, rizqi, my provision was made, تَحْتَ ذِلُّ رُمْحِ, under the, my spear, is it, what's it called? Spear. It was under my spear, the shadow of my spear, meaning whatever I gained from the battlefield. And this is the part I want from the hadith. This is where I want from the hadith. وَجُعِلَ الذِّلُّ وَالصَّغَارُ عَلَى مَنْ خَالَفَ أَمْرِي. Humiliation and to be degraded is for the person who opposes my command. Weren't we just talking about now the reasons why Allah humiliates the people? Opposition of Allah and His Messenger, wasn't that what we were talking about? Then this hadith points it out. وَجُعِلَ الذِّلُّ, humiliation is for who? وَالصَّغَارُ, and to be put down is for who? عَلَى مَنْ خَالَفَ أَمْرِي, anyone who opposes my commands. He's humiliated. He's degraded. In this world, he becomes degraded. He's worth nothing. And in the hereafter, what does he become? The hereafter, hellfire awaits him. The second thing, brothers, that also makes a people from the honor that they're in, Allah humiliates them, subhanahu wa ta'ala, is when the people come with innovation. Al-bid'ah fi al-deen wal-qawlu ala Allah bighayri ilm. When the people come with, they add things to the religion. When they add things to the religion, and they speak with what? They speak without knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah promises. He made an oath, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْكُمْ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Allah is going to give us control over this world. When what is found from us? وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِيمَانٌ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ and righteous actions. What is opposition to righteous actions? Innovation. Innovation isn't righteous actions. لِذَلِكَ وَنِي آيَةٌ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. What did Fudayl ibn Iyad say? أَخْلَصُهُ وَأَصْوَبُ. The action that two things are found in it is the action that is accepted by Allah. What is it? أَخْلَصُهُ, that which is based with what? إخلاص, sincerity. وَأَصْوَبُهُ, and that which is done عَلَى وِفْقِ مَا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, and that which is done in accordance to that which the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم used to do. If the action is that is found in the action, will it be accepted? So for us to have istikhlaf, us to get control over this world, what is needed from us? وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْكُمْ. عَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, righteous actions. What is the righteous actions? To be upon that which the Prophet was upon, and that which his companions were upon. Allah also said in the Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا الْعِجْلَ سَيَنَالُهُمْ غَضَبٌ مِّنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَذِلَّةٌ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْمُفْتَرِينَ. In this ayah, Allah said, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا, the ones who took al-ijla, the cow, they worshipped it, سَيَنَالُهُمْ, it will come to them. When Nabi Musa left, they started to worship the cow. Allah says in this ayah, سَيَنَالُهُمْ, they will gain, and they will receive from that action that they did, they will gain from it what? غَضَبٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ, Allah will be very angry with them. وَذِلَّةٌ, and Allah will humiliate them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, in this world. وَكَذَلِكَ, and like that, the same way we've humiliated them and we become angry with them, the same way we're also going to humiliate and be angry with who? وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْمُفْتَرِينَ, and we reward them, the ones who do iftira on us. Here, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari in his tafsir, he brings the call of Sufyan ibn Uyayna. That Sufyan ibn Uyayna said in regards to this ayah, وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْمُفْتَرِينَ, he said, كُلُّ صَاحِبُ بِدْعَةٍ ذَلِيلٍ, every person of innovation is humiliated. That's what Ibn Uyayna, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari brought in his tafsir, in this ayah. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said regarding speaking about a matter that you have no knowledge of. قال الله تعالى وَلَا تَقُولُ لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبَ هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ لَا يُفْلِحُونَ. Allah says, وَلَا تَقُولُ, do not say that which your tongues utter and they speak, that this is halal and this is haram, without knowledge. So do you see some people who have no knowledge, who have no understanding of the religion, and a matter is put to him? If Umar was alive, he would have called the people of Badr. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, whose companion who was promised Jannah alive, Umar would not even come and answer that question like that. Umar would have called Ahl Badr and say, what do you think of this matter? You find a miskin person like me, I will give the ruling. Straight away. Halal, inshallah. Do it, no problem. Haram. The person should not be like that. Ikhwani, the person who doesn't say, La adri, I don't know, usibat maqatilu, you destroy yourself. ولذلك the Salaf, they used to say that the person who doesn't say, well, saying لا أدري أما أدري, I don't know this, is نصف العلم, half of knowledge. To say I don't know this matter. ولذلك Imam Ibn Abd al-Barr رحمه الله, in his كتاب التمهيد شرح موطأ لإمام مالك رحمه الله, he mentioned that Imam Malik رحمه الله was asked 40 something questions, and he answered one, and the rest he said لا أدري, I don't know. Imam Malik رحمه الله, he was an imam in knowledge. So when a people start to speak about Allah, تَقَوُّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ, they speak about Allah's religion, and they start giving rulings without knowledge, this is what happens to the Ummah. Ikhwani, the last point that brings humiliation to a people, without a shadow of a doubt, is the issue regarding مُوَالَاتُ الْكُفَارِ, taking the kuffar as very close allies. And this matter is very delicate, so it has to be spoken about in a very delicate matter. Loving them from the bottom of your heart. It does not mean knowing, shaking their hands. This is not what I'm talking about. The last point is, which is the asbab, the reasonings why humiliation occurs, is when a person takes close love towards the kuffar, and he imitates them, the way he walks, the way he talks, the way he dresses, his code of conduct. لذلك Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, إِذَا سَمِعْتُمْ. If you hear, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, فَرَعِهَا سَمْعَكْ. Bring your ears close. So Allah is, who is he talking to? He's talking to you. It's either Allah is going to order you to do something, or he's going to prohibit you from something. So here Allah is going to order us something. He said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, those of you who believe, إِن تُطِيعُوا فَرِيقًا, if you obey a group, مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ, from the people of the books, يَرُدُّوكُمْ, they will take you back, بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ كَافِرِينَ, they will take you back from your iman into disbelief, if you obey them in everything. In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, those of you who believe, إِن تُطِيعُوا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, if you obey the disbelievers, the kuffar, يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَلَىٰ عَقَابِكُمْ, they will take you back to your heels, فَتَنْقَلِبُوا خَاسِرِينَ, and you will turn out to be what? A person who is destroyed, lost, comes to you. وَلِذَلِكَ أَوْثَقُ عُرَى الْإِيمَانِ, the highest level of iman is what? الْحُبُّ فِي اللَّهِ وَالْبُغْضُ فِي اللَّهِ. And Nabiullah Ibrahim that I mentioned before, as Allah said, وَمَنْ يَرْغَبُ عَنْ مِلَّةِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ إِلَّا مَنْ سَفِهَ نَفْسَهُ. No one turns away from the path of Nabiullah Ibrahim. Allah gave us example of Ibrahim in this regard. Ibrahim, look what he said. He said this to his closest person he knew, which was his father. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ لِأَبِيهِ وَقَوْمِهِ إِنَّنِي بَرَاءٌ مِّمَّا تَعْبُدُونَ. I am free from what? You worship. I have nothing to do. إِلَّا الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي فَإِنَّهُ سَيَهْدِينَ. So he's this shirk and its people, he distanced himself from it. And what did he pull himself towards? Towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the religion, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to us in the Quran, and ikhwani, no one knows Allah, no one knows his creation more than Allah. It doesn't matter how much you beautify your speech, Allah knows the disbelievers and he knows the believers. And your creator Allah is telling you this. Allah said in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, those of you who believe, لَا تَتَّخِذُوا بِطَانَةً مِّن دُونِكُمْ, do not take them a بِطَانَة. بِطَانَة, Ibn Kathir رحمه الله, in these tafsir, he said, what does the word بِطَانَة mean? Ibn Kathir said, هُمْ خَاصَةُ أَهْلِهِ, a person who is the closest from you to you, like a family member, very close. He knows all your secrets, your ins and your outs. لَا تَتَّخِذُوا بِطَانَةً, don't take them as a بِطَانَة. لَا يَأْلُونَكُمْ, they do not shorten. لَا يَأْلُونَكُمْ خَبَالًا, they don't shorten in harming the Muslims. لَا يَأْلُونَكُمْ خَبَالًا وَدُّوا مَا عَنِتُمْ قَدْ بَدَتِ الْبَغْضَاءُ مِنْ أَفْوَاهِمْ, the enmity that they have for you has started to come from their mouths. وَمَا تُخْفِي صُدُورُهُمْ أَكْبَرْ, and that which they have in their heart chest is what? It's even more. So this is it. Ibn Abi Hatim رحمه الله, Ibn Kathir brings it in his tafsir, and Ibn Jarir, Ibn Kathir brings it in his tafsir that Ibn Abi Hatim said, and Ibn Abi Hatim mentions it in his tafsir as well. To what? Ibn Abi Dahqani. That he said, قيل لعمر بن الخطاب, it was said to Umar ibn al-Khattab رضي الله تعالى عنه, إن ها هنا غلاما, here there is a boy, من أهل الحيرة, from the people of حيرة, حافظ كاتب, he is a good writer, he knows how to write, because the Muslims, not all of them could write. This man is a good writer, he could write. He's speaking to Umar. فَلَوْ اتَّخَذْتَهُ, if only you took him, Umar, you, كَاتِبًا, a writer, it would be good. He knows how to write and everything. He can write the Diwan of the Muslims and everything. He can write it for you. Umar then said to him, قَدْ اتَّخَذْتُ إِذًا بِطَانَةً مِنْ دُونِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, if I do that and I give and I bring him and I make him write these things for me, I have taken him a بِطَانَة, meaning a بِطَانَة, as I mentioned before, is a person who you take very close, a helper, an advisory. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, when I brought this athar from his tafsir, Ibn Kathir, look what he said. He said, فَفِي هَذَا الْأَثَر, in this athar, meaning this quote of Umar ibn Khattab, مَعَ هَذِهِ الْآيَة, with the ayah that was mentioned before, دلالة. Two nuskhas. One said دلالة and the other one said دليل. على أن أهل الذمة لا يجوز استعمالهم في الكتابة. That it's not permissible to take أهل الذمة. أهل الذمة are the disbelievers who live in the, amongst the Muslims. It is not permissible to take them as a writers for you. Remember this, أهل الذمة is what? He is a Muslim who's not fighting, he's not waging war against you. And he's entitled to live with the Muslim safe. And the Muslim have to protect him. They have to look after him. He lives... He's not Muslim. He lives with the Muslims. He's a disbeliever. But he has to be protected. He has to be looked after. Because he's living with who? The Muslims. Ibn Kathir is saying, from this athar, it is not permissible. لا يجوز استعمالهم. It is not permissible to use that person, the Ahlul Dhimma, who is weak. He's weak because he lives amongst the Muslims. He's asking for refuge. Even he is not allowed. التي فيها استطالة على المسلمين واطلاع على دواخل أمورهم التي يخشى أن يفشوها إلى الأعداء من أهل الحرب. Why is the reasoning? It's because it's scared that he might be able to know through the writing what the Muslims are doing and what not, and then later he takes that paper and he gives it to the enemies that are fighting from outside and he conveys it to them. What about a Muslim who is an enemy to you? Clearly, he's not from even Ahlul Dhimma. You shouldn't give him your information and your issues. And this is one of the things that humiliation comes from. When the Muslims start to take them as a bitana, they take them close. Naam. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah in his kitab Iqtida'u Sirat al-Mustaqim Mukhalafat Ashab al-Jahim. And this is the issue that goes to the youngsters and the youth. A lot of the time you see them, brothers, they're imitating the kuffar in the way they dress, in the way they walk, in the way they talk, in the way they act. And this is from the causes that bring humiliation to the Muslims. Shaykh Usama ibn Taymiyyah said, وَهَذِهِ الْمُشَابَهَةِ لِلْيَهُودِ وَالنَّصَارَى. This imitation that occurs from the Muslims to the Jews and the Christians. وَالْأَعَاجِمِ, meaning from the Furus and the Romans. At that time of his people, he's talking about Ibn Kathir. But now we have the Americans, we have the British, we have these countries. Of Hollywood. So we could change that into the, what's our current time. He said, لَمَا غَلَبَتْ عَلَى مُلُوكِ الْمَشْرِقِ هِيَ أَمْثَالُهَا مِمَّا خَالَفُوا بِهِ هَدْيَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. لَمَّا غَلَبَتْ عَلَى مُلُوكِ الْمَشْرِقِ. When the kings of Mashriq came and they overcame the Muslims. The reason why they overcame them is why? Because of the imitation of the disbelievers and the way they dressed like them and they acted like them and they walked like them and they talked like them and they started to use their gestures like them. What happened? مِمَّا ذَاتْ مُشَابَهَا مِمَّا ذَاتْ which became خَالَفُوا بِهِ هَدْيَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. And they went against what? The code and the way the Muslim is. وَدَخَلُوا فِي مَا كَرِهَ اللَّهُ. And they entered into that which Allah dislikes. وَرَسُولُهُ and his messenger. سَلَّطَ عَلَيْهِمْ. Allah placed over the Muslims at this time. At-Turka. Who are Turk? The Tatar. When the Muslims started to imitate the Romans and the Jews and the Christians, Allah brought the Tatar amongst them, who came to them. And go read this, Al-Kitab Al-Bidayah Wal-Nihayah by Ibn Kathir. The Tatar, the way they humiliated the Muslims. How did they humiliate the Muslims? The Tatar man would come, he would say to the Muslim man, a woman from the Tatar would say to a Muslim man, sit here, I will come back, I want to kill you. And he won't go. The Muslim will be sitting there waiting. She goes and she gets her knife, sword, and she cuts the Muslim man's head off. Because he's scared if he runs away, his family and everything he owns is going to be destroyed. So he prefers that the harm is only connected to humiliation. Why did that happen? Ibn Taymiyyah, who lived at that time, is telling us. He's saying this, rahimahullah. Hey, it came to them, the Tatar, and they destroyed the Muslims. Al-Maw'udi, Al-Maw'uda. بقتالهم حتى فعلوا في العباد والبلاد ما لم يجري في دولة الإسلام مثله وذلك تصديق قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تركبن سنن من كان قبلكم. He said they did to the people and they did to the land that which never has been done to the Muslim governments and the Muslim lands, and he said this is not except in hand with the speech of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تركبن سنن من كان قبلكم. You will follow and take the path of what? La tarkabunna, sorry. Sanana man kana qablakum. You will follow the paths of who? The Christians who came before you. Shibran bi shibrin wa dhira'an bi dhira'in hatta law dakhalu juhra dabbin la dakhaltumuh. That you will follow them, handsman, handsman. Everything they do, you'll do. Look at it, brothers, right now. Today I was in a house and I heard some screaming from the neighbors. I looked, I thought something serious happened. And when I looked, I was told a contest is now taking place where rappers and artists, what are they doing is they're taking buckets of water and they're pouring it over themselves. And now even the Muslims, even the households, the neighbors, Muslims, are doing it, pouring it over themselves because they saw they do it. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbul Arsh al-Azim, that He takes the humiliation from the Ummatul Muslimin, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings our affairs back to greatness. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله استغفرك وأتوب إليك